We're going to go through some things, and I want you to know that my career, 20 plus years of diversity professional development kind of activities, have spanned from K-12 through PhDs. That was actually when I was a professor at the University of South Florida. And so LSAMP BD students in the audience, in the crowd in that picture, as well as three undergrads, research projects. And on the other end, you know, there's the other kind of young age. So I'm going to talk about, and I love the fact that they asked me to talk about lessons learned. You know, so that kind of just says, wow, I can talk to you guys for about an hour on some cool stuff, and I get to pick what it is. So with that, I hope that it's helpful. Some of it will stimulate some thought, some reflection. In fact, one of these things that I'll share with you is I'm going to do a case study. Here's the agenda. So we are organized educators, and we like to know where we're going. So it's just not random stuff. It has a purpose. It has a flow. We're going to talk about a case study just to show you this can be what happened, the kind of interventions, the kind of supports, the kind of things that can happen to an individual. And I'm going to utilize the case study of myself. I'm going to show you a video from last year from Fox and Friends where I was highlighted one of the 4 weeks of February for Black History Month. And so I think that forms a case study that we'll then circle around and wrap up so you'll understand more by and by. So with that, and then we're going to do a conversation starter, and that will probably make some people uncomfortable, but we're going to work through that, okay? And I've done it at Columbia University, I've done it at University of Wisconsin, and I actually shared it with some people before I did it for the first time. And they were not of color, and they said, yes, do it. So I promise you, we're going to work through it, but it gets you to really think, so I think it's really helpful. Then I'm going to give you tools, and it's really important to have tools. So this is based on, like I said, 20 years of undergrad, grad, LSAMP, Sloan's, STEMs, national diversity projects and geosciences, pulling students from Puerto Rico, Alaska, Hawaii, everything else. And so what I'm happy to do is share with you some of what we found at work, and then we'll talk about some scholarly work behind it. So with that, here we go with the case study. I've actually shared with you the links, and they'll have the videos, but I've embedded it. So this was my first time embedding a movie. We'll see how that works. All right.
In our partnership with the Ailes Apprentice Program, we continue to honor our celebration of Black History Month. Joining us once again is Harris Faulkner, my co-host from Fox News' Outnumbered, our noon show, and the anchor of Fox Report Weekend. Harris is here. Good to see you.
Good morning. It's been an exciting morning. Got to see Ainsley for a little bit there. What a blessing.
It's great to see her back. But I always look forward to your pieces,
well,
Harris. What do you have this morning?
I'm so excited. I'm going to tell you today about a woman who became one of the first Black chemical oceanographers in all of America, Dr. Ashanti Johnson, a professor at the University of Texas at Arlington. She's helping lead the science, technology, engineering, and math, or STEM community. And take note. Dr. Johnson is more than a teacher, she's a role model, inspiring a brand new generation now of diverse scientists throughout America.
For me, the uniqueness of the ocean is the unknown, the vast amount of things yet to be discovered. There's absolutely no boundaries there.
Scientist, professor, mentor, mother, Dr. Ashanti Johnson, one of the first African-American chemical oceanographers in the nation. And a leading voice in the STEM field. Growing up, she soaked up as much as she could about the deep blue sea.
My earliest memories of the ocean would be watching PBS Jacques Cousteau. In third grade, that's what I decided I wanted to do.
We would see a spark in her eye, and then from that, expose her to as much of her area of interest.
My parents would park, and I would just go through every museum, every different exhibit, seeing the little girl grow up, little shadows of her through here, and I had no clue about what was in store. I'm glad I've been along for the ride, but I didn't know.
A ride filled with exciting stops. In 1993, she became the first African-American to earn a degree in marine science from Texas A&M University in Galveston. Fast forward to graduate school. She received her doctorate in oceanography from Texas A&M College Station. But even in the late 1990s, Dr. Johnson faced more than academic challenges.
Race was an issue, not only for me, but as the community. When I was there in my first year of grad school, they had a Ku Klux Klan rally. A professor referred to me as a little black girl. So it was a sense of isolation, but I was committed to overcoming. When I was in grad school at Texas A&M in oceanography, I was the only African American. And to date, there has not been another African American to receive a PhD in chemical oceanography from A&M.
It was after earning her doctoral degree that her true love became clear, mentorship. In 2003, NASA invited her to kickstart a pilot program to help STEM students from diverse backgrounds through mentorship and professional development opportunities.
The MS-PhDs program is taking really talented students and providing them opportunities to be able to connect with those scientists that will help them with their career to the next level. So they're already capable. We just help provide them with the platform and the belief that they can do it. Jump over those hurdles, climb those fences, do whatever you need to be. So once you get on the other side, you can affect the change that you want.
She's so full of life and love and positivity, encouragement. She has definitely helped make who I am today.
Seeing Dr. Johnson in this role as this black, powerful woman in academia, it meant so much for me. It told me that, you know what, you can achieve that as well.
I have been blessed to be able to help over 250 students in my MS-PhDs program achieve their academic dreams.
From NASA to the National Science Foundation and her leadership with the Institute for Broadening Participation, there's no question why in 2010, she was awarded the Presidential Award for Excellence in Science, Mathematics, and Engineering Mentoring.
All of you are demonstrating why teaching and mentoring is so important and why we have to support you.
It was an amazing thing. It was almost surreal. One of the reasons that there is not more diversity in STEM fields is the lack of opportunity. It's not the lack of talent for underrepresented minorities, it's truly the lack of opportunity.
People like Dr. Johnson herself can help encourage and promote and keep propelling it forward.
It doesn't matter if you are a minority, if you are different in the room, you always have something to bring, and you have to believe in yourself because you are needed.
Her mentoring to others is not out of the textbook. Her mentoring to others is because she's been there. She knows how it feels to be belittled because of her color, and as a result, not really acknowledging her intellect.
The most joyful thing that I get is watching the accomplishments of my students. I think my legacy is being able to say there was a little girl who grew up in Dallas, Oak Cliff, who said in third grade she wanted to be an ocean scientist. And ways were made, and she was able to do it. So if she could do it, then there's nothing stopping other little girls.
Bring it on in. All right, good job, Michelle.
Well, I tell you, you spend 2 seconds with
mentoring, science exposure. I'm still not on? Okay, good now? Okay, mentoring, science exposure. Thank you guys for that. Okay, also a community of support, not necessarily in your field, but a supportive community, and opportunities, having them and engaging in them. So we'll talk about those because those are a lot of positive factors that we'll put the scholarly work to a little bit later. So with that, why should we even be concerned about broadening participation? It's a question people ask. Why is this important? You know, we can do science. We've traditionally done science. It hasn't been that very diverse. We've been able to be leaders in the world on what we're doing. But we'll have this conversation starter. But we'll also talk about work of Scott Page and why we know that diverse groups are better problem solvers. So this is a very short in 60 minutes. This person, Jane Elliott, has expressed something, and it'll make you think, and we'll work through that.
I want every white person in this room who would be happy to be treated as this society in general treats our citizens, our black citizens. If you, as a white person, would be happy to receive the same treatment that our black citizens do in this society, please stand. You didn't understand the directions. If you white folks want to be treated the way blacks are in this society, stand. Nobody's standing here. That says very plainly that you know what's happening. You know you don't want it for you. I want to know why you're so willing to accept it or to allow it to happen for others.
We know that there's a problem, and I have it on. We know there's a problem, but sometimes we don't want to address that problem. And so it's not only what we know and we feel, but there's a scholarly reason, and we're going to talk through why there might be some issues, why we need to stop living in that regime, and if we're going to remain competitive as a country, embrace the need for broadening participation. So with that, let's go ahead and talk about the case for diversity. This is a picture from 1999. In 1999, I received my PhD, which was in oceanography, chemical oceanography, and there were two major symposiums for new PhDs in ocean sciences. One was called DISCO, and so they brought around the top graduates with PhDs in chemical oceanography. So it was a dissertation initiative symposium for chemical oceanographers from around the globe, and they happened to meet in Hawaii. I got in. I was excited. The other one, Dialogue, Dissertation Initiative for Aquatic Limnology and Oceanography, Geoscience maybe is the G, I don't remember, that was in Bermuda, and I got in. And so these were top experiences launching my career, and I was there, and those were wonderful. And if you look really closely, let me see if I can get this right, there I am, right there. But I was the only person that looked like me. And so scientifically, I was accepted, not an equal. Socially, I was still too young or I didn't have experience to how to blend in, okay? So where I'm in actually a sea of my peers, I really was alone. And so I was in Hawaii and I was in Bermuda and learning about these top-notch scientists, what's coming out, and we're supposed to network and then be that next generation of scientists. But I didn't know how to bridge into their world, and they didn't know how to bridge into mine. So I remembered after the poster sessions, after the symposiums, I would just go back to my dorm room, read a book, while they went out to bars and socialized or whatever it was, when that's sometimes where the important science happens. And so in addition to the academic preparation, there's some social aspects. I should have been taught how to have, you know, icebreaker kind of conversations, but I wasn't. They could have been taught how to reach out to others. Now, some of these individuals, you know, later on in my career, we've become friends. But at that point, we were scientifically, you know, you finish your dissertation, you finish your defense, you're probably the smartest you'll ever be in life. It's all in there. And I thought I would keep it in there. And so scientifically, we were amazing. But there was a lack of community of everyone. And so what I want to talk to you guys about is why we need to do some of these things. So diversity is not just a kind of fuzzy, warm feeling kind of topic. It's actually a need. And I mentioned Scott Page. Scott Page actually did some research. He's at the University of Michigan. And he looked at two different types of problem solvers, some of the same group and some of diverse groups. The diverse group problem solvers outperform those of the same grouping. And so in order to solve today's problems to become more challenging, in order to remain competitive as a country, we need to tap into that diversity of thought, because we come from different perspectives. Now, we'll tell you that his research also showed that the diverse groups were slower to come up with their solution. But that was because they needed to get a perspective or understanding of where someone was coming from. Because if you have somebody who's only learned this in this way, then you guys can come up with solutions really quick. But if you need to understand where I'm coming from, then that might take a little bit more effort. But after that effort is given and everyone has that understanding, they appreciate it, they outperform. So scientifically, it's a necessity. So just keep that in mind. So with that, I'm going to talk about underrepresented minorities. Generally, we're talking about women, persons with disabilities, Native Americans, Hispanic, Native Hawaiians, Alaskans, and other Pacific Islanders, and African Americans. That's what we're referring to. And then let's look at some data. So this is a pie chart, and what we're showing is our working workforce. And so this is in 2010 in STEM, 51% white male, 18% white women, Asian, 13, Asian men, 13, Asian women. And so 87% of our STEM workforce were non-underrepresented minorities. If you compare that to the population of the United States, 70% are non-working, non-underrepresented minorities. So there's some room for us to have some adjustment and have some increased diversity in thought. So then you look at the population 2012, because that was 2010, looking forward, here we go, non-represented, underrepresented minorities 68%, becoming smaller, underrepresented minorities more and more in the country. So if you look at 2013, the number is still the same. So we're changing the demographics of our country, but our field is remaining the same. So in 2017, this new report just came out last month. Here we go. Still the same. So we're doing things, we're embracing it. It's slow to change. How do we change the number? That's my jacket, I think. Okay. So how's it going? So if we look from the mid-90s to 2014, and this is from a 2017 report at NSF, then you're looking bachelors, women with bachelor's degrees that are URM. So if you follow it, that's where we're at. We're breaking 10%. If you look at the doctorate, then we're less than 5%. And this is a trend from mid-90s to 2014. So our level of competitiveness, again, I'm going to keep going to that point. It's not a feel-good mission. It's an existence mission for our country that we have to have better numbers. So with that, it's a complex issue. We come from different institutions. So we are at community colleges, we're at four-year institutions, we're at major research, we're at all kinds of federal labs and everything else. There are opportunities to provide our students of color with the skills needed, the knowledge needed, and just opening a door for them. And so in that, there's not one silver bullet that people are like, how do you do it? It depends. Like Byron talked about earlier, with his alliance, there are some people who universities that are great at doing certain things, but just won't work for them if they try something different. So knowing what that is, it's pieces of a puzzle to put it together. So what we've learned through the years, timing and coordination. So if you have opportunities, and this is important at various levels, if you have opportunities that you know are for freshmen that are very rare in STEM, because usually they want them sophomores and higher, freshman undergrad opportunities, then you let the high school counselors know that they should be applying to them their freshman year. Because if they don't know they exist, then they're going back to Walmart to work for the summer. And so thinking in the college mindset, if you're a first-generation student, you don't have benefit of people who've been through this process before. You don't have benefit of people who in your family are lawyers or doctors or university professors that can say, hey, when you go off to school, your job is not to come home in the summertime if you're in STEM. Your job is to find internships, find all kinds of opportunities so that when you get out the door, you're competitive. Because you can have a 4.0 with no experience, and there's going to be a rare research advisor that will take you into their lab because they want to know that you know how to actually do science. So those conversations don't happen. So again, it's not, as you heard in that video, it's not about the lack of talent. But it's opportunities, education, and knowledge. Because when it's not uncommon for you to have people who've had generations of education who really see their kids and say, okay, I'll see you for Christmas and Thanksgiving. And Johnny's over doing a international study abroad this summer, or they're in this lab doing this and all that. But in a lot of underrepresented minority families, particularly those who haven't had the college background, it's okay, when you come home this summer, I want you to try to get a job at this gas station or this or whatever, so you can save up some money so you'll be able to pay for the next semester. And so then they might perform well academically, but they're not competitive. So passing that along, that we need to be able to do this, is information that we should share, not when they hit college, but when they're in K-12, getting to the people of influence at that point. Then there's unmet need for resources. So quick little extra case study point. I got accepted into 3 universities as an undergrad. Stanford, they said, you can come. University of Miami in Florida, you can come, we'll give you some money, you can play your saxophone in the band. And that was great. Then Texas, I'm from Texas. Texas A&M Galveston said, you can come and we'll give you a full ride. And so with that, knowing I wanted to be a marine scientist, did not want to put my parents through the financial burden, didn't want to do the loans, I went to Texas A&M Galveston. So those needs, those resources are important. Other thing to know is degree choices for underrepresented minorities, very serious matter. And it's not one where you can say, oh, I want to study art history, and your family just goes, great! Because they're like, you're the smart one, you're going off to school, and we need for you to get a job. What kind of job are you going to get in art history? You should be a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer. Those are the top 3, right? Because you're smart. Scientists, you have to explain that one a little bit more. So you can imagine, as an oceanographer, aspiring oceanographer, growing up in Dallas where there are no oceans, you know, I was encouraged because I watched Jacques Cousteau, this is what I want to do, and I had people in my life that said, okay, let's figure out how. But a lot of those are no. But even with that, my mom, I remember getting my car, getting ready to go to grad school at Texas A&M, and she's like, you sure you don't want to be a medical doctor? I'm like, since 3rd grade, I've been saying this. And I don't like biology. No, I don't want to cut on people. I don't want to do this. So realize that it's a decision that they need, the families need to be supportive of. Because I've watched and I've had to talk to parents of underrepresented minority graduate students, not just undergrad students, to explain why they should stay in programs. When you're talking with seniors or juniors in college and you're saying, look, you have what it takes to go for a PhD, they're like, my mom and my dad and my family's ready for me to come out and get a job. You know, I need to get a job. And so you go through these conversations that if they come out now, yes, they'll be able to be employable, they'll get a job, this will be their earning potential, then data shows they'll probably top out right here. But if you let them go back and get a PhD, not only can they do the science, but they will be leading the investigations instead of following orders, following directions, and their potential earning power is here. So you have to have those discussions, because it's not just on a whim that we can decide what we want. Because we represent the real, a lot of hopes, prayers, and sacrifices made by families to make it this far. So I need for you to understand that. So when you see this talented student and you're saying, oh, this would be a great person, you might convince them, but you need to make sure that message is clearly enough indicated so they can go back to their families and say, hey, guess what? I'm gonna sign up for like 6 to 8 more years of school. What you think? And those are real discussions and what we have to do. So unmet needs and resources, understanding delayed gratification. Those are things that we have to understand. These are big obstacles. Partnerships. So the Alliance, Georgia Alliance, Florida Georgia Alliance for Minority Louis Stokes, don't take that. Alliance for Minority Participation. Yes, so that. We have 2 people that I was hoping to see today. One was a postdoc who came from Florida A&M, and she was in my lab at USF, and she helped me coordinate it. And she's out ill, but might be here in the morning. The other, who was a graduate, is actually now headed to Nashville for the LSM conference there. And so when Byron was talking about going across, you know, being able to be better because of the partnerships, there are seeds that have been planted within one alliance that then helps other institutions and alliances. And those are just two local examples that we could go through the list and name where people are and who's running this and who's running that, whether it's AGEPS, STEMS, all the LSMs, all these different programs have a purpose. And so those partnerships are great. We do not operate in a vacuum. We operate by partnerships. And this is us in general. And I'm saying, if you think about our field of sciences right now, they're collaborative, they're interdisciplinary, and the days of doing independent research activities really are long gone. So, and that makes it challenging because as new assistant professors going up for tenure, and your advisors taught you in the model of do a single PI project, but yet very few of those are being funded, and most of them are centers, interdisciplinary teams, other things, and if you haven't learned to engage, then it's going to be harder for you to get the tenure because you're not part of these major projects. And so opening up the avenues on both sides to have those discussions are important because otherwise we get people who then earn the PhD, and then that next hurdle after they get a tenure track position, they're trying to do it like their advisors did it, of being single PI kind of projects, and that's not working, then they're denied tenure. And so there's some more hurdles that we need to overcome. So with that, positive factors. Now this is based on some scholarly work, and I'll show you the literature behind it shortly. But these have been found to be very important for benefiting all groups, including underrepresented minorities. It's a multi-layer approach. You need to have the financial support. Cultural relevant pedagogy. So it is a lot easier to convince someone that what they're doing matters if they can see how they might be able to help society in some form or fashion. And so having that is something that we can do. When I was a professor at University of South Florida, Marine Science, I had about 4 students from Puerto Rico. I had the tools to do radiogeochemistry, and we decided we would do radiogeochemistry in Puerto Rico. And so we were able to look at some anthropogenic impacts, what man had done to different environmental areas there. So not only were they getting the skill sets that they earned their degrees, they were feeling empowered to be able to help communities because they were going back to the island to do good science on the island. So coming up with those opportunities where it just makes sense, it's science to help, that's one of the hooks that we can use. And science, you know, other than, like I said, doctor, lawyer, engineer, sometimes we don't do the best job at marketing. So having the relevancy for our community to say, hey, look, if they do this, yes, I'm an aquatic scientist. So I can tell you when that sign says sports fishing only, don't eat that. Just go ahead, catch it, weigh it, throw it back. Because there's a reason this river or this lake has that sign, and it might not be good for you health-wise. But then when you even have that discussion, you realize you're working with some communities that that's the way they stretch their dollars by supplementing their diets. Then you have this tug. But so then you can say, hey, look, this is what's going on. Or if you're environmental, again, I'm an environmental scientist, there was a major case study. There were a lead smelting plant in Dallas, and it was located right near some housing, public housing projects. They wound up relocating thousands of people because there was lead contamination. And then they wound up tearing, you know, going through the topsoil deeper, removing all the houses, removing everything else. And then they wound up doing settlements for all these families. And so now some of these families are having some mental disorders, some other issues and everything else, because you had this lead smelting plant that was near this low-income community, and there was a whole group of people impacted. So having someone who can come in and do that science to be able to say, if I learn this, then I can be able to help these groups out, help my groups out, or help other people understand, it's a good thing, right? So you don't go plant a garden outside your back door, because then you're doing the uptake. And so us finding out how to make our science relevant is very important. So authentic science engagement, whether you're reaching out K-12, whether you're going into summer projects, internships and all that, they have to have the hands-on skills, the hands-on experience if they're going to be productive. Professional development. I talked about the fact, really, I was an introvert, and by nature, I still am. And I can tell you real quickly, the first time I do a public presentation, I was nervous, my body temperature goes up, and my eyeglasses fog, right? And so I was giving this presentation, and I watched people watching my glasses, and I watched myself not being able to really see. And that was a horrible experience for me, probably them too. So for like years, I gave presentations not being able to see. And then finally I said, I have to overcome this. So I practiced and I practiced and I practiced, and finally I can keep glasses on. But that was professional development that had to be taught. I had to see what the issue is, figure out where I wanted to go with it, and get out of that introvert position. One of the ways I did that was I watched this amazing extrovert who could have anybody tell them their life story in like 2 minutes. And I'm like, why are they even telling you that? I mean, how are you doing that? But if you're thinking about going to a professional society, you're thinking about listening to a presentation, you want to meet this phenomenal scientist, after their talk, you need to say, hey, my name is so-and-so, and I really was excited about this question that you posed and what you did, and I wanted you to let you know that I've thought about doing something like that, and I wanted to know if you have any opportunities coming up in your lab, like next summer.
For you, yes.
But those things are what we teach, right? Because if you think about our protege system, historically, this is what happens. At least I'm going to go to the field of geosciences. In geosciences, you write a grant. You write a grant about a year ahead of time. You're going to really get it up and going. If it's funded first round, you don't have to do it again. And you're going to look for some postdocs. You're going to look for some graduate students or whatever. And you don't really put an ad out. What you do is you call your friend and say, hey, when is so-and-so graduating? When is so-and-so graduating? When is so-and-so graduating? You got anybody coming out? And so because of that protege system, the advisor of the grad students or the postdocs or whoever says, yes, so-and-so will finish, you know, in 6 months if you got a position for him. So he finishes up, then they have a shoe-in position, and there are people who had talent that weren't provided that opportunity for that position. So what we're asking is saying, how do we help open that up to others? How do we prepare the others when they're there to do this cold talk, come up and tell them why you should consider me for your lab for this project coming up? Those kind of things can be learned. I've recommended students to Toastmasters. You know, that's an excellent organization. And you can see people develop and to be phenomenal speakers. And so those are some tools that do. Campus and classroom climate. That interview said that I was referred to as a little black girl. I'm gonna go a little deeper in that. There was one professor, and if you have to be from Texas to know when I say he's from Kerrville, Texas, that tells the story. But I was his first African-American student ever, right? And so I write well. And I had a like B plus going into this term paper. I need this A to make an A in class. And you know, I wrote the paper, gave it to my advisor. She had a copy, gave it to the teacher, and he gave me an A minus on the paper. So at that school, A&M didn't do plus and minus systems, right? So with that, I needed an A. The A minus got me an 89.7. And so I went to get the paper, said, I really enjoyed it reading your paper. It was really well written. You made an A minus on it. I said, okay, well, can you tell me what I could to make it better? Because this is an ocean science paper in a particular discipline. And he said, well, if you weren't in the field, your references are a bit obscure. They might not be able to find them. And I'm like, but this is a paper for the field. Then he said, did your advisor help you write it? And he said, but look, you made an A minus in the class or a B plus, but you know, A&M doesn't do that. So it wouldn't be fair for me to give you an A, because it's 89.7, and because of that, you should just be really proud of the B. So that was the culture. And so my response was, no, my advisor did not help me write it. She thought it was well written, too. So I appreciate that. Have a good day. And so I could have gotten argumentative, but I realized, and this is something that we teach in some diversity projects that I work with students, I was not in the position of power. I came there on assignment to get my degree, and after that to be able to do what it is I wanted to do. I could take him on at that moment, but likely I would not have won. So what I did was I tried my best to show the department that I was worth being there. And in fact, one of my friends who was a student with me at the time, she was a white female from Minnesota, she admitted to me that she wrote on the fifth grade level, read and wrote on fifth grade level. I helped her with a dissertation. Nobody ever knew. They never questioned her, but they questioned me. And so in that, by the time I finished, they kept seeing evidence and evidence of the level of ability that I had, that at the end of it, the dean's office, when I was finishing my PhD, said, you know, you were one of our best graduate students. Would you ever consider coming back to be on faculty? And so at that moment, you know, and I'm very transparent. I don't play poker or anything else, because you could see it on my face. I said, you know, I put up with some things as a grad student that I would not tolerate as a colleague. And so until some of these people are gone, you'll never catch me as a faculty member here. So the education, top notch. Life experiences have helped a lot, but it was hard. And so when you're looking at students who are the only or the just the few, then know that it's more than what's happening in the classroom, it's the subtle things that are going on as well. And with that, we have to have the support system. We need to be able to have the positive factors. We have to think about our climate. Have a closed door conversation. Have people come in like Byron or others to say, hey, let's talk about your program for real. You keep getting people in the door, but they keep leaving. Why is that? Why? You know, and I stuck it out at A&M. I mean, I was gonna be an oceanographer. I knew that's in third grade. I was only African-American in my college, so I hung out with a lot of engineers of color. And so you had PhD engineers at the time who started out PhD students who decided, I'm leaving. I'm gonna go with a master's and go somewhere else. So having those conversations about why can't we keep them? So it's not just about getting them in the door, but what's the climate that we set for them? And you say, oh, I have wonderful undergrad summer research opportunities. One of the things I love about the SOARS project in Boulder, Colorado, is they have, I think, 7 different mentors. They have a community mentor, a writing mentor, they have a research mentor, all these different kind of people, because they want to really embrace the entire student. You will find out that research students of color who are going to some institution where they're not a community of people of color like them, they go in the lab and they work, and then they have to figure it out because they're not invited to go socialize. And so then you want them to sign up for 8 more years of this, right? For grad school. And then after that, you want them to say, until I'm 65 and ready to retire, my whole world professionally is just gonna be my STEM area because this community is not embracing me. So for us to remain competitive, I'm going back to that, then we really, really need to understand that it's not a feel-good thing. It's not something that we just, it's the right thing to do. It's something that we're going to have to do, okay? So with that, role models, we talked about that. You know, I just got an email last night from a parent of a young girl. I've gotten about 5 this year, especially Black History Month, doing little reports. And they say, can you have time to meet with me and everything else and all that? And so, you know, we have these discussions online, then somebody's FaceTime with me, and those are great things and all that. But I'm really glad that the internet exists, because I can be a role model and have hand-on interaction with some, but not with everybody, right? Because there is not enough time in a day. And then if you roll that into an African-American or minority faculty member at a university, they become the go-to for every student of color. And they're mentoring your students. They're not only role modeling, but they're mentoring. They're having closed-door sessions because these students are stressed out. And then you're like, well, she's not being very productive. So I need for you guys to understand that there are some things that if we take this on holistically, if we look at our climate and our culture, if we say, you know, there's a role that I can play too, And it's not, oh, you're African-American chemistry major and there's one African-American chemistry faculty member. Y'all go all talk to her. That's not setting up a system of success. That's setting up a system of, I can only go talk to somebody who's like me. And it's also for these scientists or these professors, then I have to take care of the whole world that comes towards me. And if not, then I'm seen as this not so nice person. And then when I get reviewed, you're saying I'm doing too much service, I'm not doing enough this. But where is this support? So there's some things that we just take a look at our climates that we could come up with some fixes. So with that, mentors and mentoring, I talked about role models. We can be role models. The best role model I had in oceanography growing up was Ernest Everett Just. He was an African-American scientist, wound up being the advisor for Omega Psi Phi fraternity when they were started. And guess what? He was dead before I was born. But that was the only African-American that I knew of an ocean scientist. So I knew everything. He was called the Black Apollo. I knew everything about Ernest Everett Just. And so it was not until I was in grad school that I met two African-American scientists in the aquatic field. They were both biological. And I was like, oh my gosh. But that was before internet. That was long distance was real. So you wrote a letter. So those kind of things, there wasn't a lot really going on. But having role models, you can identify some. The more you can, take an opportunity in your classroom when you're talking about somebody who's done some phenomenal work. You know, if they happen to be a color, or go out and search for somebody who's doing something relevant and bring it in the classroom. You know, those are things that you can do. Mentoring. We mentor a lot, and some people are really good mentors, some people are not, and some people think they're really good mentors, and they're not. Because I've had conversations with students around the country, and some of them surprise me, where there's some well-intended individuals. And I'll go back to my case study. My PhD advisor was a white female, and she grew up in ocean sciences, is really tough on women in general. And so she was isolated. So she was had an isolated research experience, a single lab, not many students, and then here I am, the student of color. You know, we're just, she and I are together. You know, the guys don't play well with us. So that's our relationship. And what she did, because she wanted to help me out, was she said, your qualifying exams are going to be harder than anybody else's, because I want there to be no doubt that you were qualified. She was trying to help me out. I was like, why can't I just do the same as the other PhD students? You know? But she wanted it to be no doubt. My dissertation, you know, I was blessed to have associate dean of it from engineering on it, a dean of my college, and I went to them after having done a lot of work. I went to my committee, said, look, I think I'm ready to go now. And they looked at the draft and said, well, yeah, you should have gone. I said, well, my advisor didn't think so, because she wants to make sure that there's no doubt. And so in trying to be helpful, she was actually harming. So she didn't understand that she wasn't even letting me to measure up with the same bar, right? I had to exceed everybody else who was there to be seen as equal. And that's something that people of color know well. But again, I was not in a position of power to be able to say, dang it, I'm done. Because you're done when your advisor tells you you're done. But I was smart enough to go to my committee members and say, hey, what you think? Can I go now? And so having those advocates are important. So you might not be somebody's advisor, you might not be a co-advisor, but you can be a committee member. And that's an important role to play. And so I've served on committees of people not in geochemistry because they knew they needed to have that advocate. So allow yourself to be that advocate. So then dealing with mentoring, one-to-one, it's important. Faculty to student is important. Within the MS-PhDs program, which is what I really won that award for, these were the types of mentoring activities we had. Some of them were just at a conference. So a phenomenal scientist said, look, I can spend like 4 or 5 sessions with this one of your students, and they can go to this, and we can talk about it. I can help them network with this person and all that. And then, you know, God bless them. Right? Because I'm too busy, I'm going to be over in Germany next year, but I can work with them right now. So that was the one-on-one. we had long-term mentoring. There are some people who still have mentors from 2005 that's in the program and who've done phenomenal work, and then they come back. So it's important to have various parts of mentoring, and again, like I said, SOAR's program is an excellent model for that. Authentic science engagement, we've hit on that. And one of the things that you'll find out with, I think, people in general, and then people of color as well, is that there is a desire to give back. Good people want to help other good people. They just want to help. And so, and I'm saying that because this is a picture of me doing my first research cruise out in the middle of Gulf of Mexico when I was a grad student, and I needed a lab assistant to go out there with me. And so I picked an undergrad who was in civil engineering, and I was able to help him out on getting him some experiences. You know, having opportunities for others is so very important. And one of the young ladies in the picture there is actually an associate dean of college science now, and so I'm really proud of her. But having those opportunities, and then the next generation. They might not do like the cutting edge science, so they're gonna get some Nobel Peace Prize or something, but they can get the exposure. And so those are things that are important. Professional development, it takes institutional leadership if you're gonna have change. So it's not just what the PIs of a project can do, but what's the buy-in going up? Because if you want it to last, it's going to have that buy-in. Engaged faculty. So different conferences, and this is at the SACNAS meeting, where you have, you know, African Americans, Puerto Ricans, Native Americans, all doing phenomenal, and they're serving on a panel. We're serving on a panel to help encourage undergrads on how to obtain graduate funding next generation. So these are things that not only do they want to do their science, but they want to try to give back to the next generations. Having workshops to handle the important issues, and taking advantage of the elders in the field. So this is Ambrose Jarrell. Ambrose? Yeah. Okay. Ambrose Jarrell has been one of my mentors since I was in grad school. And so he's been my mentor since maybe 97. He was just with me in San Francisco. I won two AGU fellowship and a couple of awards, and he was there. And so since 97, we've had a relationship, and I've run MS PhD since 2003. Every year, he's there to mentor the next generation. And so having people that are committed are those kind of people that we need. And so with that, Ambrose said, it's not like, okay, you were in the 2005 program, goodbye. He still is connected to everyone he touches. So with that, campus, classroom, and climate, we talked about it. We need to make it supportive. I'm sure that that professor from Kerrville didn't know that he was probably offensive when he told me my paper was good in one hand, and then he asked me if somebody helped me write it in the other hand, right? He didn't know that. But someone should have had a closed-door discussion with him. But I wasn't the one to do that. So when we look at recruiting, and so now these are kind of the practical tools. If you look at recruiting into your various programs, does your material even represent diversity? So when you're looking at, you want to fill a research experience, a grad student position, or postdoc position, you look at your website for your departments. What do they look like? Like, it's taking a diverse community to support our world, our earth. You look at this picture, and you're asking folks to sign up for grad school, to move beyond. Who's the instructor? It's not a trick question. Who's the scientist? That one, right? Yeah, these are the students? Okay, let me ask this one. Who's the educator? And do you see how dorky the scientist looks? So, but again, if you're an underrepresented minority and you're talking about going into these things, who are you learning from? What will your world look like? Now, when you look, who's doing some phenomenal science right there? It's a female, and she's of color. So if I'm a female, I can relate. If I'm of color, I can relate. And so I'm like, wow, she can do that, and that's pretty cool. I'm interested in chemistry too. Maybe I'll look there. So there are little tweaks that you can make. Again, learners, the instructor. Now this is a very cool picture. So if you're looking at where do I fit in, I can be pretty, I can do cool stuff. So look at what it is, and I can tell you one of the things that I remember some undergrads coming to me one time I did a presentation. They said, we want to tell you, we really appreciate you wearing makeup and looking nice. I'm like, okay. But I'm a geoscientist. And so a lot of the geoscientists they've seen who've been female have chosen not to do that. And they said, you know, and we understand that you have kids and all that. That's great, because what we're hearing, what we see, is if you're a female, you don't really look like one, and you don't have a life. And so from that point on, then even if I'm dead tired, if I'm giving a presentation, they're going to be out. Like if you catch me at home, I have my hair in a ponytail and I'm not with makeup. But it was important for them. And so since it's important for them to understand that they can fit in, then it's something that I can role model. So with that, diversity is in your court. We can do some things. Real quick, interactive skills. Hearing versus listening. Oh my gosh, we think that we are so great at actually hearing people. But sometimes we're really not, right? We're just kind of waiting for them to finish talking so we can tell them what we think. We're not really digesting it and responding. And so when you're trying to have that mentoring relationship, it's important for you to understand their perspective. And because of that, you can't already go into the meeting and say, I'm just going to tell them this and this is all the problem there. Because that might not be the solution. Because one of the things that I had a meeting with my students from Puerto Rico, I was committed to telling them, I have a problem with how late you get back in after Christmas break. We have science to do. And you're staying on that island too long. I'm just telling you, you're staying too long. So I was committed to telling them that. And so then I started the conversation. And then they educated me about Three Kings holiday on their island. That for them is as big as Christmas, if not more so. And so I understood at that point, since that happened in January, they weren't coming back until after that. So I had to adjust and say, okay, well, instead of just putting liquid nitrogen in the machine that should last 10 days for you to get back, I guess we need to shut it down so we don't break it. So I had to hear what it was they would have to say and then accommodate some things that were important to them. So we gain information from listening. It improves the relationships. What if I made them choose? If you're going to stay in my lab, you're going to miss this important holiday with your family, get your tail back in. Or you need to find another advisor. That wouldn't have helped our relationship. So making those things to solve the problems, and my problem was I don't want the crystal in my detector to break because it warms up. So we're going to turn it down, turn it off. And we did that. So with that, make eye contact. There are several of you who are really good active listeners, and you've been nodding and smiling. And you might be with me, and you might just be nodding and smiling and doing active listening. But that's what it takes. We make the eye contact. We have nods, we show appreciation. That makes a person feel valued. What they have to say is important. And then when they're talking to you, paraphrase. So what I understand you to say was this. And so I can understand that, but I want you to consider this. So you're hearing, you're digesting, and you're still communicating. And so those are things that are really important. And we're so smart, we just want to get them to be quiet so we can tell them the solution. Do not interrupt. Do not interrupt. Let them talk it through. And let's not talk so much. So those are some things that we've found to be successful, and there's a link for that down there. So mentoring professional development. I've done this, and you guys can do it a different way. I did a presentation, done a couple places, but the first time was at the Florida, Georgia Peach State Alliance Conference. Byron was in there handling your business, and I'll talk to you about it briefly, but it's targeted for underrepresented undergrad students. And it just really gives them to take a self-inventory on where they are so they can figure out what they need to do. And so that's important. So what you want to do is empower them to look inward, to look at opportunities, goal setting, those type of things that, you know, some people already know. Others we can still help them with. self-assessment, skills, career exploration, personality testing. One of the things that I'm an ocean scientist, and I would have undergrads who wanted to apply to my lab for a research experience. I'm like, African-American females in particular, do you mind getting muddy and your hair getting messed up? Because if you do, my lab is not for you in the summertime. So there are some great labs that one person said, all of my oceans are on my computer and that's the way I like to keep them. So you have to know personalities and what's involved in it so that you're not putting somebody who has different strengths or different likes or dislikes and having them do something else. And that's for everybody. But those are things to take consider. And I said that about hair in particular because we're not wash and go. We really are not wash and go. It takes a while to get these looks back to where they need to be, okay? And so keeping that in mind, then, you know, having those real just direct conversations, which I can have, or other people who learn these things can have, Susan could have them because she spent a lot of time understanding and working with some students, these things can happen. And having development plans. And we ask the students, what are your long-term goals? What are your short-term goals? What are you planning on accomplishing next year? What are you planning on accomplishing in 5 years? And some of them are like, they can rattle it off. And others are like, looking at you like, what? I'm going to take this class. For what end? To what purpose? Where are you trying to go? So those are questions we have to ask. And then I talked about introvert, extrovert. You got to be a team player in STEM now. You have to be a team player in STEM if you're going to be successful. You have to network. You have to reach out to broad groups and develop an elevator presentation. Those are the things that we do in our MS-PhDs project. So we meet with the students before the huge Umbrella Society for Geoscience meeting, AGU, starts. It has about 40,000 people. We bring them there 2-3 days early. We do all this professional development. Their elevator speech is down pat. And not only that, but the community of students have heard elevator speeches, so they know what their peers are interested in. So if they happen to see, you know, opportunity, it may not fit them, but the other one, then they go network and help. Say, hey, look, this person over here is talking about that. Let's go find them. So those are kind of things, and maximize those interactions. So this is some of the handling your business kind of questions, and I have a whole list that's in the presentation at the end that you can have. But how many participate in research experience at your home institution? And a fair amount of underrepresented minorities will say, yeah, you know, I've worked in somebody's lab, I've done this. How many of you have gone away? Fewer, right? How many of you have published? You're like, published as an undergrad, because that's not their frame of reference, but now that's the bar that's being set for competitive students for grad school. So, you know, not just doing presentations at a conference, but being like third author or so on a paper. And if you're not that, then you're not as competitive. But in order to do that, how do you get there? So you go ahead and you negotiate that project at the beginning, say, hey, look, I want to do such a phenomenal job on this project you have me working on this summer and keep in touch with you. So therefore, when the paper comes out, I can be one of the authors. Does that sound okay? And if you're saying, I'm going to work hard, I'm going to make an impact, then they're going to be, oh, yeah. And so then they increase the level of project they would have had in mind. So maybe they just thought, hey, look, we really need somebody to help wash beakers. And so we're going to bring somebody in. But they're like, oh, this person's expectation is they're going to be a co-author. Then we need to go ahead and have them do something that's worthy of that. So in having those conversations early. So there's a whole series of questions that I ask that even goes into social media. You know, how many of you guys would be comfortable with me looking at your Facebook page right now if I was interviewing you for a job? If not, you need to clean it up. So those kind of things. And I say these are not random questions. They're points to make a profile of competitive applicants. And we want everyone to be competitive. And this is what it takes. So with that, I'm going to tell you real quick, and this wraps up the case study, and we'll be pretty much done. Telling your story. So I talked about some of my story. So you guys should have, when you heard some of the things, and maybe there was something kind of similar or something that sparked something, hey, yeah, I had a teacher, or, you know, I had some aha moment or something that happened in my life, but this is why I'm here. Where those students need to know those moments. Because you might not be of the same ethnicity, but you could have had something in common. that they'll be like, oh, okay, you know, she came from a rural area, so did I. And so that makes it easier to bridge with that person. So have them, you know, at the beginning of the semester, just say, hey, look, you know, I'm gonna talk to you. I wanna learn more about you, and I just wanna share some things about me. So with that, there is, from the Center of Ocean Science Education Excellence, this thing called concept mapping. That's a free tool. That's just wonderful. And so you heard about the whole thing on video, but this is how it starts to look as a concept map. There's Jacques Cousteau, there's the aquarium where I spent my time, there's my mom who said, you're gonna go off to school, do great things, and figure out what you wanna do in life. So they'll say, oh, I had a cute picture with my mom when I was little. You know, and I remember when she was telling me what I was gonna do when I was going off to kindergarten. So you have these moments, you have teachers that are supporting you. All of these things are concept maps, and it took me from third grade till I went off to college before I really explored. So 9 years of my life, I was preparing, and that felt like forever to actually be able to do my science. So with that, you talk about people, experiences. This is the Texas A&M Oceanography Building where my room was on the ninth floor, and I was the only one in the building. And I'll tell you, being nice counts, because there was a sense of isolation, but we were out on a cruise in the Gulf of Mexico. And there was an Asian female there. And so I'm a nice person, I was nice to her. She got back to the building, and all of a sudden the Asian students start asking me if I want to eat lunch with them and everything else. And I'm like, what's that? Because I was nice to one of theirs on the boat, all of a sudden they were appreciative, or they opened up their world to me. And so I was like, this is strange. Why do they keep asking me? But that's what that was about. I use this too. I'm actually standing on a river in Ottawa at my first conference for Arctic research. And I saw people ice skating down that river. I'm from Texas. They were ice skating to work, and I'm from Texas. So I was like, I need to go stand on that picture, that river. That was my first international meeting. The other thing I use this picture for is this is in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I use it to explain to undergrads that science happens when science happens. They got on station at 3 o'clock in the morning. If I had told that captain I will be there to collect it at 9, I would have missed that science. And so having our students just in general now understand that you have to do the work when it's time to do the work, and it's not at your convenience, is an important message. So with that, making good impressions, this was me as a grad student, and this was an undergrad. He wound up being my first PhD student. He's on faculty in Puerto Rico now. He made a good impression to me when he was an undergrad. So when I got my first faculty position, I reached out and said, hey, Warner, what are you doing? And he was finishing his master's on the island. And because of the good impression, then he had an opportunity to become a PhD student, and he's since mentored others. Giving back, this is what I call the Tama girls. I was the first at Texas A&M Galveston. These all three have gone on to receive their PhD, and she's doing a postdoc in Italy right now. A major kind of thing of life stories, what have you been, where have you gone, and how, so other people can relate. That's the whole point. It's not really about you, it's about other people being able to connect with you. So you sum it up, this is all positive factors. And so you want to know and want the students to identify what factors have been in their lives and what they might be missing, so they'll know how to converse with you or others to share with them what the needs or desires are. So with that, here's some publications that have come out. This is Ocean Sciences grad in graduate school. And so that was a paper that I published last year. This was reaching out to high school guidance counselors. And this one came out last February in American Sciences with Sigma Xi, is how to recruit and retain underrepresented minorities from K through PhD. So those are kind of a variety of papers that are out. And we've been able to do phenomenal work with MS PhD's program that's been going on since 2003. My alumni make me proud. And so I'm really excited about that. And also doing workshops such as what you're doing with others, and that's with the STEM HRD. So with that, I would like to say thank you for listening and see if you have any questions. And that's it.
All right, thank you very much for that very interesting and informative talk, and we'll take questions from the audience.
Hi, I'm Lisa Ketchmarchik. I'm a computer scientist who is, for the past 7 years, I've been running an evaluation business. I'm also a faculty. A lot of the stuff you said totally resonated with me as a woman computer scientist. Right toward the end, as you were talking about developing a concept map and talking about the positive factors that have influenced career trajectory, I wondered, how do you handle the situation where you've had one of these really negative experiences, like the ones you describe, when that negative experience actually caused you to make an important career change that turned into something positive? But in other words, you had a reaction to this horrible experience and did something very different. So the pivotal experience itself is not positive.
So what I can tell you, and I'll go back to those positive factors, is there was one here. When that happened, Pastor James and Wanda Turner, they were in the same town that I was in grad school, and they kind of adopted me. And they knew what was going on. So every once in a while, they would say, hey, I'm downstairs, come get in the car, it's time for you to go. Because they knew what was going on. And so with that, I'm sure I had that conversation about, guess what this guy told me? And it's just like, okay, well, that's great. So I'm sorry it happened. So how are you, what are you going to do about it? And so at that point, so Texas A&M College Station, phenomenal graduate education. And I say that, and the dean knows it, and actually the former dean even heard me give a presentation with some of these points in it. It was a strengthening experience. It was I became stronger there. With that, I was also committed to help others after that. So I actually took that negative experience and said, I'm gonna help it be easier for the next crew come behind me. And that's how MSPhD was actually conceived, based on that. And I took students back to AGU, which is AGU meeting, and in 97, I said I would never go to another one. Because there was me, and there was one other African-American who was a vendor out of 20-some thousand people, okay? And again, as a scientist, now I understand that people only see each other once a year, and I'm catching up with you, and blah, 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 and there's some little shy person over there, and I'm not paying attention to them, because I'm connecting with all of my colleagues that I only see once a year. In my opinion, they were excluding me, they weren't nice, and I don't even want to go back. And on top of that, my advisor, I talked about her, and I go see her. She's well-intended. She had me published under my first initial, because she said Ashanti is too ethnic, and we don't want people to judge your work by your name, we just want them to see your work. So some of my first papers are A. And so I did Russian Arctic research, and I had a poster at that meeting, and there's these German scientists and everything else. I'm standing up in front of my poster, as you should, and they're looking around me. They keep looking around me, and I said, well, is there anything I can help you with? Well, no, I'm looking at that. Well, it's my poster. Can I answer a question? Oh. And that happened so many times that I said I would never go back to AGU. But when I had an opportunity, and I told the president of AGU this just a couple of weeks ago, I'm very transparent. When I had opportunity, what I did, when I realized how important that meeting was for networking, connections, professional development, is that's the first phase meeting where every MSPhD student goes. We help navigate it for them. We help them feel comfortable there. Because if they're going to be in the in crowd, they need to be able to be successful at that meeting. So for me, it just made me more committed to make it better.
Right, so what do you put on the concept map so that when you have that conversation, say with a student, it doesn't go into the, because you talked about wanting to talk about the positive factors.
Yeah.
What goes up there?
So that would be resiliency to me.
Okay.
So overcoming some negative stuff and getting back up and being that more committed.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So I apologize, but it was so good to see my cousin up there. But you also had another family relative, Porsche Spence.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I figured that out. Okay.
And she's working with me at NCCU.
Okay.
So I'm Tanya Gerald Goins.
Okay.
And I'm a co-PI on an INCLUES with my husband, Gregory Goins, who's at NCANT. And so everything you were saying, I went through in my graduate experience. And so, but I decided before I went to graduate school, that I wanted to go back to my alma mater, NCCU, and help students navigate. And so I've been able to do that as well. So I applaud you. I don't have a question for you because I already know, but I applaud you because sometimes we don't like to air the dirty laundry, but if we don't air it, then nothing's going to be done about it. And so we want more to go into, to become PhDs, because we help make the decisions, not only at the national, state, regional, whatever level, but also with our families. You know, you didn't talk about it, but this could go into health disparities. If we're not there to represent, then there's a whole lot that goes on that people aren't aware of. And case in point, my father was in the VA last year this time. If I didn't understand, I'm a pharmacologist, that's what my degree is in. If I didn't understand medicine, if I didn't understand how to talk to the medical doctors, the surgeons, they wanted to amputate my father's foot. They just wanted to say, well, he has an infection. But when I questioned and said, well, what type of infection? Have you done an MRI? Can it be treated with antibiotics? Is it osteomyelitis? That's when the conversation changed. So I tell that story to my students so I'll help them understand. It's not just about you getting a degree, but it's also enabling you and empowering you to go back and help your community. So I applaud you and thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, we maybe have time for one more burning question. We're a little off schedule, so we'll have to.
So I'll try and do this and do it justice. What about the unique challenge that we nerdy old white guys face when, you know, the idea that we're either part of the problem or we're part of the solution? And maybe it's that we're, I speak only for myself, I worry about being paternalistic, I worry about being unhelpful and trying to be helpful. Are there things that we can do a better job of, sort of from that place where folks presume the old white guy's got all the power anyway? What is our contribution, broadly speaking?
Okay, and I'll tell you that after I've done this presentation, there's been usually white males that come up and say, I understand that now there's a role I can play. Yeah. So being that champion, being that person who helps open doors, and also saying, hey, look, if you want to be successful, this is what it takes. You know, having the discussion of the unwritten policies, the unwritten rules, delayed gratification. Hey, I didn't start off as a full professor or, you know, associate professor. I had to be the low man on the totem pole, you know, early on to doing some things. Having those things. Also, in closed doors, there often are not champions. And you guys are inside those doors most of the time. And so having those discussions of saying, yeah, their GRE score might not be the top, but they've had some really cool experiences. And look at this letter of recommendation. Because that's whether the give is where you guys can be very impactful. Because there's room to give. Yeah.
Quick comment on that. Just resonated with me. You talk about what can you do. A couple of weeks ago, I turned 53. But I have a mentor who is a retired IBM executive, an old white guy. So I'm just saying, you can open up, just take a chance. I met him at a meeting. We got to talking about, I don't know what, but we connected. And that's been 6-7 years ago. So I go and talk, and we role play sometimes. I tell him, oh, this is happening, and we role play. And some days I'm like, Steve, I don't want to hear this today. We go at it. But he's opened up, he's learned about me, he learns about my environment, what makes me tick, so forth and so on, and therefore, he has remained one of my, I can't thank him enough. But there's no, he didn't do anything for me per se, but it's the relationship. And so I think just offering that yourselves to another can be of great value.
And I mentioned it at the grad level, but I also want to let you know, most of my mentors have not been of color. Ambrose is like one of the rarities because there weren't a lot in my field. When I was applying for my first faculty position, Ellery Engel from Georgia Tech, was my mentor, my guide. So I had two different universities that wanted me in industry. And so I really didn't want one. They said, this is how you do this. You got two people going for universities going for you, and you really don't want that one. So you tell this one that you need a startup package like this. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's a lot. I can get away with less. They're like, no, you don't say you get away with less for your startup package. This is your point to shoot for the moon, because you're not gonna, it's never gonna come again. But in, you know, kind of from the making do approach, growing up with that, you know, of stretching as far as you can stretch, then as women or as of color, then we get by. But it took him to say, no, you don't want that, so you get them to give you a package here, then you take that letter over to this other one, and they're gonna give you more. I'm like, oh my gosh, do that? And so at the end of the day, I wound up getting the largest startup package that University of South Florida Marine Science ever gave. And it's because a white guy told me how to negotiate that whole process. So there's all kind of levels you can play. And he had been in enough search committees to know how that's done. I hadn't. And so there are different roles that we can play at different phases. So anyway.